New York Times with Maureen Dowd's article, and I can tell you when you're starting a publication, that kind of coverage is just incredible. So thank you for that, Maureen. We've had many trips to Ireland. The most emotional one, I think, was taking her and Peggy back to their home area in County Clare and seeing the house where her father, who was a real hero, left many years ago. And Maureen talks a lot about her father, and so does Peggy. He was a hero cop who took a bullet when President Truman attempted assassination of President Truman. And he was also the president of the National Ancient Order of Hibernians. But her mother was also a very, very special person. I never actually had the pleasure of meeting her, but people tell me if you want to know Maureen, know her mother. Is that true, Peggy? I think it is. But I think that the fact that she came down from Washington today is a great example of unselfishness, and I know privately how good she has been to people in trouble, how incredibly warm and caring she is about people, even though she's called the Cobra by George Bush, which is an interesting nickname given what Trump was talking about snakes last week. But I think that it's people like Maureen that keep the world safe. I know that sounds insane, but there hasn't been a political leader who hasn't been reined in by her in the last 30 years. It's an incredible power, and she uses it very wisely. And I think she makes an incredible difference when she writes about somebody. That magnificent interview a few weeks ago about what was going on with Tarantino and the movies and all that. So thanks for all that, Maureen. It's fantastic. Something of the Catholic nun in you. I also want to thank some other people who are here. Obviously my wife Debbie for everything she has done. My daughter Alana, who's making her debut. Hi Alana.
Hi.
And our cousin Kathleen, who's just as mischievous as she is. Hi. And Michael Campbell is here from the publisher Sky. I got it wrong. Skywalker Press is wrong, I know.
Skyhorse Press.
Michael and Dermot McAvoy, who's also here, did a fantastic job with the book, with the editing and the sequencing of events. And I really want to thank Dermot for his tremendous editing job as well. Thank you, Dermot.
Thank you.
I think what I wanted to write about was an annoyance that I had many years ago with the Ken Burns series, The Civil War, where he never once in the course of I don't know how many programs ever mentioned the Irish or asked the question, how come everybody in the Civil War spoke with an American accent, especially when 120,000 of them were Irish born or Irish American. So what this book is an attempt not to write about the war so much, but to write about Abraham Lincoln and the Irish, because when Lincoln was president, 19,000 Irishmen were coming in, fleeing the aftermath of the famine, and they became very much entangled and intertwined into the political scene, as we all know. But when you think of all the enormous hardship they faced, incredible hardship, and I know we talked today about racism, but when you think about the Know-Nothings and what they did, they burned 20 Irishmen alive in Louisville, Kentucky in 1866 for trying to vote. That's what we were dealing with back then, and the Irish had to come through that. And any time I see an Irishman now having it in for immigrants, as too many of them do, I wish he could read his own history about how deeply constrained and deeply saddened his people were by what happened to them back then. Lincoln was all about the Irish. I know I say this a lot about the Irish, but actually when you research it, his children were brought up by Irish nannies. Mary Johnson was an Irish woman who was the only woman who could handle Mary Todd Lincoln's moods. And Lincoln paid her an extra dollar a week because she threatened to quit. Catherine Gordon, another Irish girl, looked after his four kids, but she incensed Mrs. Lincoln by bringing her lover in through the back window. He was known to be a great speech maker. He regularly recited Emmett's speech from the dock. And in one case, when he was forced with the commutation of a death sentence, the man who was defending the man who was under threat of death sentence asked him to remember Robert Emmett, and the kind of prosecution that was carried out against him, so he spared the young man. In 1846, he was one of a very few members of Congress who passed a statement about the terrible treatment of the young Ireland leaders, O'Brien and Mitchell, and said what was done to them was to suppress any effort to establish a free government. Speaking about John Hannigan, an Ohio politician who's the son of an Irishman, he said, "He's the son of an Irishman with a very large share of that generous feeling which generally characterises the Irish." That's not something that's ever considered all that important, but Lincoln's regard for the Irish, even though they disagreed politically, compared to the people around him, compared to his wife, who was at times favourable to the Know-Nothings, compared to his law partner, Herndon, who was viciously anti-Irish, compared to the structure of politics in the Republican Party, which were anti-slavery and then crazily anti-Irish as well. It's amazing that Lincoln succeeded the way he did. And when he eventually made his political career, one of the people that actually stood in his way is a forgotten Irishman, James Shields of Tyrone, who was 16 when he left Tyrone, on his way to live with his uncle in New York. When he got to New York, the uncle had died. He joined the US Army and became such a great soldier that he became a lieutenant general. And after the war, he settled in Illinois, and he was Lincoln's biggest opponent. And Lincoln and he fell out so badly that they had a duel. They met for a duel in the field of Missouri. Fortunately, the seconds managed to take care of the issue, and they didn't actually complete the duel. But ever after, Lincoln said it was the most disgraceful moment of his life that he did that. When he got to the White House, Lincoln, I read what a local journalist who frequented the White House, Noah Brooks, said. "The president has succeeded in getting about him corps of attaches of Hibernian descent, whose members are about as disagreeable as it can come to be." If you look at the names of the people around him, Charlie Forbes, Edward McManus was the doorkeeper who met him as the first man when he came into the White House. Edward McManus was from Kerry and had served six presidents. The names of all those around him gave clear evidence that Lincoln was very, very pro the Irish, even though people around him resented the fact. Lawrence Mangan, who was driving Lincoln, said, "President Lincoln was a grand man, quiet and gentle in every way. He was always so thoughtful of me and those who served him. Though I was only over from Ireland, he always treated me with the same considerate bestowed respect that he gave to his regular cabinet and staff." And Mangan describes how he would drive Lincoln out to the old soldiers' home, and they'd look through a telescope at the night sky, and Lincoln would always bring Mangan with him to give him the opportunity to see the night sky. The old soldiers' home was where Lincoln spent his summers, and they weren't old soldiers at all. They were actually young soldiers, because they were Civil War veterans with nowhere else to go, and most of them were Irish immigrants. And when he was there for 2.5 months every year, he paid particular attention to the Irish. He would have heard the Irish language spoken very frequently. And after one stay at the old soldier's home, he was asked about immigrants, and he said, "Donald Trump, please take notice. I regard our immigrants as the principal replenishing stream provided to the United States by Providence." He loved Irish music. He loved Kathleen Mavourneen. And The Last Rose of Summer, when his son Willie died, he requested that The Last Rose of Summer, which is by Thomas Moore, be played. And of course, he had some amazing people around him in the Irish community. Corcoran, Maher, Hughes, and a woman called Jenny Hodges, who's been lost to history, but I think will shortly be resurrected. Jenny Hodges came to America and became a man called Albert Cashier. She fought in the war for the Union side, and she's alone among all the women who fought in the war in that she didn't change back to being a woman, but lived her life as Albert Cashier afterwards, which was quite incredible if you think about it for the time. I think that the Fighting 69th obviously played a huge role, and particularly their pastor, who was very, very famous at the time. And no event during the Civil War bound Catholics and Protestants more united than Father Corby's blessing to the soldiers on the second day of Gettysburg, when he blessed all the soldiers, Catholics, Protestants, any other religion that were there. And it's been remarked upon as the moment when the Irish Catholics felt part of America for the first time. At Gettysburg, there's a great untold story about the fighting 69th of Pennsylvania and Pickett's charge on the third day when Pickett aimed at the center of the Union line. And guarding the center of the Union line were 69 Pennsylvanians led by a man from Derry and all Irish born but immigrants who lived in Pennsylvania. And as Pickett's charge advanced, 13,000 men ready to do battle, the regiment on each side of the fighting 69th deserted, leaving the 69th as the only force that could stop this oncoming army until reinforcements were called. They all died, but they did stop the advance. It was the furthest advance of the Confederate Army in the history of the Civil War, and it was stopped by the Pennsylvania Irish. So these are the kind of histories that I think are so important for us as Irish people, that we remember this history. And there's no commemoration of the Irish who died in the Civil War. There's commemorations for the Irish of the First World War, Second World War, Irish Wars of Liberation, but there's none for the people who fought in the Civil War. 120,000 soldiers, 35,000 died. And it's interesting to study on the other side, of course, there were Irish as well. And there were two people in particular, a priest called Father Bannon, who was incredibly influential on the Confederate side, and a bishop called Patrick Lynch, who was a slaveholder. And Patrick Lynch was probably the worst bishop in the history of religion. He decided that it was good practice for Confederate soldiers to be allowed to rape black women because it meant they wouldn't rape white women. And he's actually on the record stating that. So Bannon was sent to Ireland on a mission because towards the end of the war, the immigrants from Ireland were starting to make the difference in the size of the two armies. And Bannon and Bishop Lynch were sent to the Vatican and to Ireland to prevent more Irish coming and joining the army. And they were sent by Jefferson Davis himself, who met them in his house and told them that if the Irish didn't stop coming, the Civil War was lost. Of course, the Civil War was lost anyway. And we go to the saddest moment of Lincoln's life, obviously, what happened after Ford's Theatre. And again, we see the Irish. There were four people going to Ford's Theatre that night. There was Burke, Francis Burke from Roscommon. There was Charlie Forbes from Dublin. And there was Mr. and Mrs. Lincoln. And one of the untold stories about that period is Burke and Forbes and Detective Parker, who was guarding Lincoln, went next door during intermission to the Star Bar and had a drink. And sitting right beside him at the bar was the assassin Booth. And when Booth came back, and they came back after the drinking time, Charlie Forbes was the last person who could have stopped Booth assassinating the president. But Booth was an incredibly famous actor, and Charlie did not know that he was intent on killing the president. But the fact that you had so many Irish around the president that night is something that I haven't seen written anywhere. And when he died, there's another wonderful story about the aftermath of the assassination. When a man called Doherty, an Irish man, Irish Canadian, a leading Fenian actually, was sent to pursue Lincoln. And sent to pursue Booth. And he pursued Booth and pinned him down, as we all know the story. He was shot by an Englishman called Boston Corbett and killed. But the credit went to Edward O'Doherty. And in a small graveyard in County Roscommon, there is a headstone, and it says, Lincoln's Avenger. That was Doherty. It was the family grave, and it's still there, and it says, Lincoln's Avenger, in the midst of a Sligo graveyard. Even though Doherty himself is buried in Canada, a mysterious American general came back and built that monument to the man who avenged Lincoln's death. So that's a brief summary of the book. If you want to pay $20, you can buy it at the But I do want to say that it's an incredible history we have, and we don't know the half of it. If this little book contributes in any way to us understanding who came before us, and if it contributes in any way to people not pulling up the ladder after them, but remembering those men who came off the famine ships and fought against slavery and saved America, and fought for Lincoln, then we should remember ourselves in this generation, the other immigrants from all around the world who are being mistreated in this country at present. But I do think that Lincoln's arm points the right way and his history points the right way towards justice and towards recognition of everybody, no matter where they come from. Thank you very much.
Please go back to the bar. Thank you, John, for starting for a lecture venue.